for your son, precious Jesus, my master. We say thank you for the privilege you have given us, my master, to come both morning and evening, Lord, to come into your presence, Lord, to learn your word, my master. What a privilege, O God. Many do not have this privilege, my master. We are so grateful and we are so thankful to you, my master. Help us, O God, not to take this privilege for granted, my master. Lord God Almighty, I thank you for the opportunity you have given me, Lord, to speak for you, Lord, my master. As I'm going to speak for you, my master, I hide myself behind the cross. Let only your word will be heard in this place, my master. As your word says, Lord, heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will never pass away, Lord. Whatever the word you are going to speak today in this place, my master, I pray none of the word will pass away, but it will accomplish for the purpose you are going to send forth, my master. Lord, we give you glory, honor, my master. All belongs to you, my master. In Jesus most and mighty and matchless holy name I pray this prayer, Lord. Amen, amen. Praise God, church. Praise God. Are you all glad? Hallelujah. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. So everything begins with word. What is word? Words consist of sounds and vibration. Our words are the creator of our universe, our lives, our reality. I repeat, our words are the creator of the universe, the creator of our lives, the creator of our reality. Are you able to hear? See, without words, a thought can never become reality. For example, so if I think myself, Caroline is so beautiful, if I don't say express, she will not know what I'm thinking about her, correct? So words will never become reality, sorry, thoughts never become reality until unless you speak. If our words and thoughts are the very tools with which we create our reality, then surely they are our most powerful tool. Surely we should only pick the very best words in order to create our very best reality. At the same time, words have the power to produce positive or negative consequences. They have the power to give life through encouragement and honesty, or to crush and kill through lies and gossip. Our words have the power to build up or tear down. So the message, the title of my message today is the power of words. Proverbs 18:20 says, a man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth. From the produce of his lips, he shall be filled. Here, fruit represents word. So this verse can be read as like this. A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the word of his mouth. So inner satisfaction comes from what we speak by our mouth. We are justified or condemned by our own very words. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 to 37. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. Verse 37. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. So note here in verse 36, these are all the Jesus words. So if you see in your Bible, it will be written in red color. These are all Jesus words. He says every idle word. He is not saying that for every word you speak, you will give account. So he says every idle word. So we must be very careful what we speak. I believe God records every idle word we speak. I was pondering how he is recording. In a modern era, we have so many technologies to record. I do not know about his recording system, but I am sure he records every idle word we speak. Why I say so? In Hebrews chapter 8, verse 12 says like this, I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins, and their lawless seeds. I will remember them no more. You may say that this verse was written for the new believers, but it says that I will remember them no more. That means he records every idle word we speak. And when we ask of his forgiveness, he forgives us and he erases them. That's why it says, I will remember them no more. That means he writes something. So when you go and ask forgiveness, he erases it. But it does not mean that we can speak anything we want and come back and ask his forgiveness. Today morning also we learned the sowing and reaping principle. So what we sow, we will definitely reap. So remember, we will have to bear the consequences. We may speak some idle words. When we realize this is not right in accordance to God's word, we may ask his forgiveness. Surely he will forgive and he will forget. But we will have to bear the consequences. Proverbs chapter 18 verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. As I said, our words have power to produce life or to produce death. So we all know the story. Moses sent 12 men to spy the land of Canaan, and he asked them to bring back the report of the land. So 10 of them came and they gave negative report. They said, the people who live over there are very strong and they are very powerful. We cannot attack them. They are stronger than we are. Bible records in Numbers chapter 13 verse 32, they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. In essence, they spread fear among the fellow Israelites. If you further read in Numbers chapter 14 from verse 1 to 3, so all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. And all the children of Israel complained, note the word complained, against Moses and Aaron. And the whole congregation said to them, if only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in this wilderness. Why has the Lord brought us to this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and children should become victims? Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? See, the following the scandalous report of the 10 spies, the people wept that night. They spoke death upon themselves. What did they say? They said, it would have been better for us to die in this wilderness. Why God wants us to take us to the land where people are stronger than us? So they were murmured, they were complaining about against Moses as well as God. Now Numbers, interesting this verse, Numbers 14 verse 28. Many times I have read this chapter, but when I saw this verse, it walked my mind. It says, the Lord is saying, say to them, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my hearing, so I will do to you. Remember this verse. What the Lord is saying, whatever you have spoken in my hearing, I will do to you. Verse 29. The carcasses of you who have complained against me shall fall in this wilderness. All of you who were numbered according to your entire number, from 20 years old and above. The Lord said, I am going to do exactly what you have spoken. I'm not going to do anything differently. Whatever you have spoken upon yourselves, that's what I am going to do. In verse 28 says, death and life, remember, are in the power of the tongue. Now, the same chapter, verse 36 to 37. Let's see what happened to these people. Verse 36. Now, the men whom Moses sent to spy out the land, who returned and made all the congregation complain against him by bringing a bad report of the land, those very men who brought the evil report about the land died by the plague before the Lord. For the first 10 men who brought evil report, who murmured against Lord, who murmured against Moses, they died first. The very word they have spoken exactly happened to them. Let's see What happened to the rest of the congregation? Now Numbers chapter 26 verse 2. The Lord told Moses, take a census of all the congregation of the children of Israel from 20 years old and above by their fathers' houses, all who are able to go to war in the land. See, this is the second census of the nation of Israel on the plains of Moab. First census was taken at Mount Sinai when the people of Israelites, they prepared their journey to enter into the promised land, which is recorded in Numbers chapter 1. That was the first census were taken. Now here the Lord told Moses, take census again in chapter 26. Verse 63 to 65, Numbers 26. These are those who were numbered by Moses and Eleazar, the priest, who numbered the children of Israel in the plains of Moab by the Jordan across from Jericho. But among these, there was not a man of those who were numbered by Moses and Aaron, the priest, when they numbered the children of Israel in the wilderness of Sinai. For the Lord had said of them, they shall surely die in the wilderness. So there was not left a man of them except Caleb the son of Jephunneh and Joshua the son of Nun. See, exactly the people spoke upon themselves. What did they say? It's better for us to die in the wilderness. Exactly it happened. None of them, 20 and above, were alive when they were taking the second census, except Caleb and Joshua. This is recorded in the New Testament for us, for our warning. If you read 1 Corinthians chapter 10, it's recorded about the complaining and the grumbling of the people of Israelites and what consequences they faced. It's for us, our warning. So it's better care. We should take more care when we speak what we speak. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Let's see why Caleb and Joshua survived and entered into the promised land. What did they speak about after they spied out the land? Numbers chapter 14, verse 6 to 9, verse 6. But Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. And they spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, the land we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord delights in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Verse 9. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. So what Joshua and Caleb, they were telling the congregation, yes, the men who are living over there, they are stronger than us. You're right. The fact is, the men on the other side are looking stronger than us, but the truth is, the Lord is with us. The one who promised us is with us. The Lord already has promised in Exodus chapter 6 verse 8. What the Lord told them, I will bring you into the land which I swore to give it to Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a heritage. I am the Lord. So indirectly, the Joshua and Caleb, they were reminding the congregation, oh, remember what the Lord promised us. He is capable to take us to the land. Do not look around the circumstances. Yes, the fact is, what you are saying is right. The men are stronger than us, but believe in the promise of the Lord. That's what this Joshua and the Caleb, they were encouraging the congregation. There's a huge difference between fact and truth. The fact is, economy is down. Yes, people are losing job. There is job loss. This is fact. But the truth is, our God is our Jehovah Jireh. He is our provider. This is the source of everything. Amen. He will open door for his people. He will make a way where there seems to be no way. Isaiah 43:19 says, I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. How he will do it, that's none of our business. Our duty is to speak life in our negative situation. So these two men are encouraging the congregation not to be afraid. We will conquer the land. But they failed to listen to these two men. But they spoke death upon themselves. So this is the reality. When most of the people, when they talk about facts, we believe that is the truth. When minorities speak truth, we will not listen. Correct? So here 10 men came back and told, no, 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 we cannot go into the land. If we go, we all will die. Our wives will become widow. Our children will become fatherless. Better we'll go back to Egypt. So the congregation listened to the majority of the lies of the enemy. They failed to listen to the truth of what God sent two strong men to speak. We also sometimes do the same thing, right? Now, Numbers. Now, Bible records Joshua and Caleb were the only adult Israelites in that first generation entered into the promised land. It's recorded in Numbers 26, verse 65. For the Lord had said of them, they shall surely die in the wilderness. So there was not left a man of them except Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun. So what we understand from this story, death and life are in the power of the tongue. So the people who spoke death upon themselves, they faced death. None of them, 20 and above in the first generation, did not enter into the promised land where the Lord told them, I will take you into the land where milk and flow honey. But only Joshua and Caleb, about 6 million people left from Egypt to go into the promised land. Only two of them from the first generation entered into the promised land. Why? They spoke life. They did not speak death upon themselves. Amen. Now, Genesis chapter 1, verse 2 to 3. Verse 2 says, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. See, in the book of Genesis, when darkness covered the face of the earth, God did not report about the circumstances. He knew the things were created by the power of his spoken word. So he released the word, what he wanted to create. He didn't say it's so dark, darkness is everywhere, it's never going to change. We say something, correct? No, it's never going to be changed. I'll live like this only. I can't see anything. Darkness is hovering over the face of my world. God did not say anything about the circumstances. He did not report about the circumstances. God declared what he wanted to create. What he said? He said, let there be light. The light came into being. God created everything by speaking. If you read the Genesis chapter 1, how the creation came into being. If you read the verses, then God said, then God said, then God said, everything came into being. We know that God created the whole world by speaking it into existence. The world was framed by the word of God. He created the visible world out of nothing. If you read Hebrews chapter 11 verse 3 records, what God speaks come to pass. Over and over in Genesis chapter 1, we see the words, and God said. Whatever God said became reality. He said, let there be light, let there be plants, let there be living animals, let us make man in our own image. Whatever he said, it came into being. He said, finally, let us make man in our own image. All of these things in the world are a reality today because God spoke them into existence thousands of years ago. All of creation is a result of God's word spoken in the beginning of time. Now, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 says that God created man in his own image and after his likeness and gave him complete authority over all the earth. So humankind was created in the very likeness of God himself. Just as God had the power to speak and create things from his spoken words, we too have been given the power to speak and create by our own words. I repeat, how God had the power to speak and create things from his spoken words, we too have been given the power to speak and create by our very own words. Amen. It's interesting. Once God spoke and created everything in the earth, Bible records he rested. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 2, God rested from his work. And by the amplified version says like this, and by the seventh day God completed his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. So after seventh day we don't see any creation by God himself. So what did he do afterwards? Instead, he put man over his creation and gave him the power of authority over it. God blessed Adam and gave him dominion over everything in Genesis chapter 2 verse 7. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath or the spirit of life, and man became a living being. It's amplified version. So the original Hebrew words for living being are speaking spirit. So we were created to be like God in his ability to speak and create by our very own words. It's interesting. See, God created everything for man to live on this earth before he created a man. So how thoughtful he is. He's our good father. He did not create first day man and then he created everything for him to live. But he created everything first before he created man. Praise God. Matthew chapter 6:8 says, for your father knows what you need before you ask him. So our father knows what man need to live on this earth. So he created first everything, then last he created man. What a good father we have. Amen. As we read in Genesis chapter, we are created in his image. So we are to speak like him. You have the same power and authority to create. The Bible says that you are created in the very image of God. That means whatever the quality he has, the same quality you and me have. If he had the power to create by speaking his word the whole universe, we too have the same power by speaking to create our own world, our own reality. But it does matter what we speak. As we read in Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. If you want to create life, speak life. If you want to create death, it's up to you. Genesis chapter 1 verse 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. How? Male and female, he created them. As I mentioned, he created us same as he. That means we have the same authority to create as he has. We read Numbers 14:28. Say to them, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my hearing, so I will do to you. So what are we speaking today? The God saying, whatever you are going to speak in my hearing, I will do exactly what you have spoken. So speak life. Speak to create, speak to build, speak to bless others, speak to move the mountain which is stopping in your way. Speak health, speak prosperity, speak health, speak wealth, speak good. Whatever you are going to speak in his hearing, he is going to do it. It's up to you what you want to speak, what you want to create. It also says that his word does not return void. That means his mouth is your mouth. What you declare will not return void. Isaiah 55:11. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. So when God created us, what he, how he has created? He has created exactly the copy of him. So his mouth is our mouth. Even when Moses, when God was calling him, he was giving him a lot of excuses. Lord, I am this and this, I cannot go. If you read Exodus chapter 4 verse 12, God said, I will be your mouth, you go. So what he is saying? You're not going to speak. Whatever you're going to speak, it's from me. I will be your mouth. Today God is saying, my mouth is your mouth. So whatever you are speaking, it will not return to void, but it will accomplish. Amen. So resist the urge to report what your present circumstances reveal. Speak into the atmosphere. Release and declare God's truth. So I mentioned earlier, the fact and truth are very different. In the book of Genesis, it was a fact that the world was dark. Maybe there are facts in your life, looks like dark. But if you continue to report the facts, nothing will ever change. Truth is what God says will be. Facts are what man can report. So let us speak the truth. Let us speak God's word. Let us declare what the word of God says. So if you want to change your circumstances, you have to change your words. If you continue to merely report the facts, nothing will ever change. Change your words and change your circumstances. Declare what you want to create. You will have the very things your lips speak about it. See, throughout the life and ministry of Jesus, he only spoke the creative and life-giving words of his Father. People saw and recognized the power and authority of Jesus' words. It is recorded in chapter Luke 4 verse 32. In the book of Luke chapter 4 verse 32. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. Creation was established by God's words and responded to the words spoken by Jesus. So if you read in the New Testaments, most of the miracles of Jesus were done by speaking. Very few of miracles, if you see, he touched the blind man's eyes, he touched. But most of the miracles done by his faith-filled spoken words. Jesus spoke to calm the raging sea. He spoke to raise the widow's son. With faith-filled words, Jesus called Lazarus, come out of the tomb. Jesus spoke creative words to man with a withered hand. Jesus spoke healthy words to the woman with a spirit of infirmity. To the paralytic, Jesus' words were, rise up and take up your bed. For the centurion, even the centurion, he came to Jesus for his servant was sick. What the centurion man told Jesus, you don't need to come to my house. I am not even worthy. Just speak one word. My servant will be healed. So Jesus spoke. Every miracle occurred. Very few miracles, if you see, he touched, he did in a different form. But most of the miracles of Jesus were done by just speaking words. So the power of words is on your lips. Job chapter 22 verse 28. You shall also order a thing, and it shall be fulfilled to you, and the light shall shine on your ways. See, Joshua knew that when he declares, the word will do its part. Joshua knew. Joshua commanded the sun and the moon to stand still. God performed Joshua's words and stopped the universe. Joshua chapter 10 verse 12 to 14. Then spake Joshua to the Lord, and he said, sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed. How? Joshua was astonished. He went into the space and stopped it? No, he just spoke the word. He knew Job 22-28. He said, no, you shall order a thing and it will be fulfilled. I believe Joshua and you are not different. We were created in the same image. If Joshua could do that, we can also do that by speaking the faith-filled words. Amen. Elijah stopped the rain for 3.5 years with words. Today morning also, Pastor was talking about it. 1 Kings chapter 17 verse 1. And Elijah the Tishbite said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain this year, but according to my word. He didn't say according to God's word. He said my word. See the audacity of Elijah. So who is Elijah? He is just an ordinary man like you and me. It's recorded in James chapter 5 verse 17. Elijah was a man with a nature like us. So he's not different. He's not a superficial man. He's same like you and me. So what's the difference? He spoke life. He spoke faith-filled words. According to Elijah's word, the sky was stopped for 3.5 years. So what we are learning from this? When our words are God's word or in agreement with God's word, they do not return to you void, but they accomplish that which you and God please and prosper in the thing whereunto you and God send them. Jesus said, we are one. Therefore, when your words agree with God, they become one with God. When your words agree with God, they become Lord over your situation. God works with his word and brings them to pass when spoken in faith. There is the only difference between Joshua and Elijah and us. They spoke in faith, so God performed exactly what they spoke. So here I urge you, church, whatever circumstances you are in, whatever the situations you are in, you may think that it's never going to change, but I promise you, if you speak in faith, the promise of God, it will accomplish for which you are sending forth. Amen? We'll quickly move on, time is over. One thing you notice, till you speak, God will not work. Confess with your mouth God's word of blessing. As I mentioned, words carry enormous power to heal or wound, to encourage or dishearten, to speak truth or deceive, to build or break. So learn to use your words to their greatest potential, including how to connect more meaningfully. So far we learned our words impact our life as well as others' life. So it's very important that we should speak positive words in order to agree with God's plan. See, either our words agree with God's plan or agree with Satan's plan. Only two things can happen. Psalm 107 verse 20, He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. So as earlier I mentioned, the centurion came to Jesus. He told, you don't need to come to my house. I'm not even worthy. Just speak one word. My servant will be healed. So when you further read the full story, the moment Jesus spoke, the servant got healed where? At his home. Servant was far away. When Jesus uttered a word, the servant got healed at the same hour. It is recorded in Matthew chapter 8. You can go home and read it. So when Jesus spoke, what happened? Miracle occurred. Healing occurred. Demons ran away. We are the disciples of Jesus. We are the followers of Jesus. As we read, God created the same image of him. So we are also having the same power what Jesus could. Even Bible records what Jesus saying, you will do greater than what I have done. By what? Just by speaking faith-filled positive words. Then we must speak the same language of Jesus. Today, what are we speaking? I'm sick and tired. There is flu in the air. The weather has changed. This cold weather, I will always fall sick. My father is diabetic. My mother is hypertension person. So I am. It is genetic. Remember, the moment you utter a word, Satan take hold of the word. See, Satan cannot read your mind. Remember that. I just want to mention it. Satan cannot read your mind. But only God knows what you are thinking before your word comes forth. But the moment you utter a negative word, Satan take hold of it. You don't need to invite him, he will automatically come into your life. So be careful what words we are releasing. God sent word, he healed them and delivered them. So today, question to be asked is, what are we sending? But it is important what kind of words we are releasing. Are we releasing words that will agree with God's plan or agree with Satan's plan? So the question to be asked. I'm not saying you don't say the truth. If you are running through 104 degree temperature, if someone comes and asks you, how are you brother, how are you sister? I'm doing very well by God's grace. Your temperature is 104. Your face will, obviously will, we will know that. I'm not saying do not say the truth. You say the truth. Yes, I'm running through fever, I'm sick. But do not end there. You say, I am sick, but I will be healed by the stripes of Jesus. Yes, today I don't have a job and I know my God will open the door. Because his word promises, he will bless the hands of my work and I will eat the fruit of my own labor. So I will have a job. So you end with God's promise. Do not stop, do not report what your current circumstances says. You end with God's promises. We must speak positive words even our situation does not conform it. Our mouth should all, how it will happen, how you will speak positive when your situation is negative, the key to that, our mouth should always praise God even in time of difficult situations. If you do so, I promise you, you will not speak a negative word even your situation conforms negative. If you continue to praise God, if his praise is continually on your lips, you will only speak positive word even in your negative situations. Psalms 34:1, I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise shall continually be in my mouth. David is saying what? I will bless the Lord only in my good situations, when I am happy, when I am joyful. No, he doesn't say that. Bless the Lord at all times. This should be our attitude. No matter what happens, we will bless the Lord at all times. Bless means highest form of worship. Bless and praise are the same word in Hebrew. To bless a person means is to speak well of him. When people speak well of the Lord, that's called praise. If we do so, I promise you, God will fill your mouth with good things. Psalms 103:5 says, who satisfy your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. I like this amplified version. It says, who satisfies your mouth, that is your necessity and desire at your personal age and situation, with good, so that your youth renewed. How? It's like the eagles, strong, overcoming, soaring. What does the Lord satisfy with? Good things. Not rich things, not many things, not everything I ask for, but good thing. That means all my need is fully supplied and taken care. That's called good things. Amen. So who will get these blessings? The answer is in chapter 103:1. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Speak well of the Lord in order to get the blessings which are mentioned from verse 3 to 5 of Psalms 103. If you want to receive the blessings of verse 3 to 5 of Psalm 103, what we must do? We must bless the Lord at all times. So far we have seen we must speak positive words. How did we get saved? I think all of us are saved, correct? How did we receive salvation? We believed in our heart and we confessed with our mouth. So heart and mouth are connected to each other. Romans 10:8-10. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So how did we get saved? We believed in our heart and we confessed with our mouth. Yet many times we fail to continue to speak God's word beyond our salvation. So heart and mouth are connected to each other. Matthew chapter 12 verse 31 to 37. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For a tree is known by its fruit. Here tree represents heart and fruit represents mouth. Verse 34. Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That means the source of our words is the heart. If you think about something long enough, it's going to come out from your mouth through words. Verse 35. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. 37. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. So Jesus reminds us that what we speak reveals what is in our hearts. What kind of words come from our mouth, that is an indication of what our heart is really. You can't solve your heart problem just by cleansing your words. You must guard your heart. You must allow the Holy Spirit to fill you with new attitudes and motives. Then your speech will be cleansed at each source. If our source is clean, then our water will be clean. If the well is clean only, you will get the good water, correct? So if your the source means here heart. If our heart is clean, the words what we speak will be life-giving. Matthew chapter 15 verse 18. But those things which proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile a man. These are Jesus' words. I like this amplified version. Whatever comes out of the mouth comes from the heart and makes a man unclean and defiles him. So we must keep our source. We must guard our heart. That is the source of our words. What we say matters. So by knowing the truth about the power of the words we speak, we can change the course of our lives and impact the world. At salvation, our eternal status is changed. How? By our confession, by speaking with our mouths and believing in our hearts, and that Jesus raised from the dead. So by through this, our eternal status is changed. Psalm 19:14 says, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight. David did not stop. May the words of my mouth, O Lord, be pleasing in your sight. He said, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Because he knew out of the abundance of the heart, our mouth speaks. That is why he's saying, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight. So see, our words are directly linked with our heart. We work hard to keep our outward appearance attractive. I'm not saying don't dress up nicely. You must do it. But what is in our hearts is even more important, because the source of our words is our heart. If your words are to be aligned with God's word, then you must keep your source, that is your heart, to be clean and pure. Someone said, our words are full of blessing when the heart is full of blessing. If we fill our hearts with the love of Christ, only truth, purity, and life-giving word can come out of our mouth. If our hearts are full of compassion, our speech will likely be positive and upbuilding. So how can we be assured of producing good words that have a positive impact? How can we do that? There are many ways we can do that. I just littered down because of the time. We will go through only 3 points. Number one, by guarding our hearts. As I mentioned, the source of our words is our heart. So we must guard our source. Proverbs 4 verse 23. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. See, Solomon tells us to guard our heart above all else. Everything we speak or do come from our heart. The foremost important is to guard the source of our words. Number two, by hiding God's word in our heart. Psalm 119 verse 11, I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. See, as I mentioned, out of the abundance of the heart, our mouth speaks. See, if your heart is full of God's word, then our mouth will speak positive word in our negative situations. We will not sin against God by speaking our own negative word the way the people of Israelites did and they perished in the wilderness. If we hide God's word in our heart, our mouth will speak only positive word, because God's word speaks only life-giving word. So we will also do the same thing. How? If we hide God's word in our heart. Number three, thinking in our heart about God's goodness. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. So what Paul is telling us, meditate upon this goodness of the Lord. So your word which is going to come out of your mouth will be positive and good words and life-giving words. See, word connect us to God. How we get, how did we get saved? We believed in our heart, we confessed. So the words connect to us, as well as the same time the word connects to each other. If you are disconnected from someone, I believe it is nothing else, it's because of words. So we must be careful what we speak. Words are wonderful when they are used in a good way. They can encourage, edify, and give confidence to the hearer. Proverbs 15:23 says, a man has joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season, how good it is. See, words are powerful. They can either build up or destroy. Solomon devoted many of his proverbs to the consequences of speech. Your right word spoken at the right time can actually be life-changing. Your wise word can bring joy to all who hear it. But foolish words can bring a person's own destruction. So we must be careful. You may say that you are quoting all Old Testament verses. Now we are in New Testament. We are blood-washed children. In New Testament, James cautions us in chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. In the same way, the tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. Verse 6, and among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It is a whole world of wickedness, corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire. For it is set on fire by hell itself. Tongue means here words. Tongue represents words. I elaborate it. See, the uncontrolled tongue can do terrible damage. Satan uses the tongue to divide the people. Be careful. Idle and hateful words are damaging because they spread destruction quickly and no one can stop the results once they are spoken. We must be careful what we speak, thinking we can apologize later, because even if we do, the scars remains. A few words spoken in anger can destroy a relationship that took long years to build. So before you speak, remember, the words are like fire. We should be cautioned what we are speaking to each other. It is important in all relationship, in our marital relationships, parent and children relationship, or our colleagues at work, or the church relationship, or with our extended family, any relationships, before we speak, we must think what we are speaking. So once the word is spoken, it cannot be taken. So then how our speech should be, how our words should be? In Colossians chapter 4 verse 6, let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. It is important always to be gracious in what we say. Seasoned with salt means what we say should be tasty and should encourage further our dialogue. So what we must do to have gracious speech, what we must do? Very simple. Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. That's the only way our speech can be gracious. The words you speak to others can leave a huge impact and create a lasting memory, either good or bad. So it's super important to choose them wisely. Words can make or break a relationship, and your choice of words and the way you express yourself can accelerate or kill your relationship. I come across some powerful quotes on power of words. I thought I will share it with you. Ian, it's there? You didn't put it there? Okay, sorry. I'll just read it out. Be careful with your words. Once they are said, they can only be forgiven, not forgotten. Words are free. It's how you use them that may cost you. Raise your words, not your voice. It is rain that grows flowers, not thunder. One kind word can change someone's entire day. Handle them carefully. Them means words. For words have more power than autumn bombs. See the dangerous of the power of words, what we speak. I like this quote by Mother Teresa. Kind words can be short and easy to speak, but their echoes are truly endless. The tongue has no bones, but is strong enough to break a heart. So be careful with your words. Joel Osteen says like this, be careful what you say. You can say something hurtful in 10 seconds, but 10 years later, the wounds are still there. Good words are worth much and cost little. Your words have power. Speak words that are kind, loving, positive, uplifting, encouraging, and life-giving. So far we understood the power of our thoughts. We would guard them more closely. If we understood the awesome power of words, we would prefer silence to almost anything negative. In our thoughts and words, we create our own weakness and our own strength. Our limitations and joys begin in our hearts. We can always replace negative with positive. So far we learned how heart and our mouth are linked, how we can produce positive words, and we also learned the consequences of our words, what we are speaking. So we must be careful what we speak. As the creator of your universe, what you say goes. Therefore, next time you catch yourself about the negative words, regain control and frame your word choices so that they have a more positive impact on your world. For example, if you say always, I'm so fat, I'm doing as much as possible, I'm doing exercise, I'm diet, I'm not losing weight. So you can frame your words like that. What you can say, I'm in a process of becoming healthier each and every day. Don't say that you eat everything and don't do exercise. You only said that, so I'm saying that. No, you do your part. But the way you speak, you should say, I'm in the process of becoming healthier each and every day. I get closer and closer to my ideal weight. I'm just giving an example how you can speak. Your words are the paint with which you paint your reality. Choose them wisely and positively to create a reality that is good for you. Remember always that this is the theme of the message. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. If you want your words to be productive and fruitful in your life and those who are around you in your life, only one thing we must do. What we must do? Moses commanded Joshua in Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, "Do not let this book of law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written on it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. If you do so, I promise you, you will speak only life-giving word of God through your mouth. You will only agree with God's plan to prosper you, and God, you will have good success by speaking His word through your mouth." So the condition, the whole message can be summarized in this one verse. Do not let this book of law depart from your mouth. What do you need to do? Meditate day and night. As I mentioned, our words are directly linked to the heart. What are we meditating? What are we thinking about long enough? Only that is going to come out from our mouth. If you meditate on word of God, if you memorize God's word, if you hide His word in your hearts, only those life-giving word will come out of our mouth. So only we speak life in every situations. We will speak life people around us. We will encourage people. We will build up people to create a community that can raise an army for Jesus. Amen. Praise God. I believe this word has blessed you. This is the power of words. God bless you.
Let's all stand in the presence of the Lord and thank the Lord for this word. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, at times, anyway, nothing to do with the fat thing, you know. She didn't speak about me anyway, so don't take it wrong. We never argue about it. She's the one feeding me, so I become fat. So don't worry about it. What I'm trying to say is, you know, we speak many words, you know, kind words to each other, right? But the one wrong word, actually we catch hold of it. That's how it happens. You know, we come across the same thing with my, you know, our marriage life. I speak thousands of words, you know, of good things about her. But one wrong word, she keeps it remembering many years. 10 years before you spoke. It happens to everyone. So we must be careful what we speak so that it adds value to each one. And then, you know, it brings life to everyone, every situation. You know, I wonder when God created Adam in the Garden of Eden, you know, when God's presence was there, when God was there physically, and the angels were around him, right? Angels were, we learned in LCU. You know, then angels were looking when God created Adam in his own image, angels saw two gods in front of them. In fact, you know, because God created a man in his own image, that means angels saw two gods, you know, whatever the command we do, they go and operate in our command and then the things come to pass. The same thing, we are created and released into this world where we will create whatever God has told us to do, we will create it. We are here to build it, not a tear. You know, one thing I took it today, that we are here in this world to build, not a tear. Of course, to tear of the kingdom of devil, to empty the hell and populate the heaven. That is the only purpose we are sent as the ambassadors of Christ into this world, and then we bring forth every situation. We create life. Amen. That's what we must do. Father, we thank you for this day, O Father. Thank Lord, my Master, you spoke to us, O God, through your servant, that Lord, we are created to speak life, O my Master, into every situation, not to tear anyone, O God, but Lord, to build everyone, to, O Lord, expand your kingdom in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Your very purpose, O God, O my Master, will be accomplished through our lives in the name of Jesus, O God. Lord, this evening, O God, we repent of every wrong word we spoke, O God. O Lord, let them be detached from our minds, from our hearts, O God, from our tongues, O my Master, in the name of Jesus. Lord, fill our hearts, fill our, oh my Master, minds, oh God, with, oh Lord, your word, the encouraged word, oh my Master, so that, Lord, we speak out of the abundance of the heart the good words in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every word we spoke against each one, oh God, oh my Master, Lord, we remove them, oh God, oh my Master, in the name of Jesus. We repent, oh God, oh my Master, this evening, Anything, O God, that word brought displease, O my master, in your heart, O my ma, we grieved your Holy Spirit, O God. We ask of your forgiveness, O God. And Lord, we will not speak any wrong word to anyone, O God. Even, O Lord, to the situation, O God, we will not speak wrong. But Lord, we will always speak positively, O God, so that, Lord, your kingdom will be established, O God, in every situation of our life, in the name of Jesus, O God. Lord, even over our children, O God, whatever we spoke wrong, O God, O my master, let them be removed from their heads, O God. Let them be removed from their lives, O God, in the name of Jesus. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, we speak life over every situation, O God. The life-giving words of my master, every one of my master, are surrounding us, O my master, so that, Lord, your kingdom, O God, of my master, will be established in every situation in the name of Jesus. Because always, O God, you spoke and it created, O my master, history. The same way, O my master, we will speak and we will create history, O God, for your kingdom, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, create in us a clean heart this evening, O God. That, Lord, our hearts, O God, filled with your words, O my master, with praises, with psalms, with hymns, O God, so that, Lord, every word of my master will come forth and, Lord, will go and accomplish everything, O my master, what the purpose has been sent for, in the name of Jesus. We do not want to send to the devil's kingdom some wrong words, O my master, and, Lord, it will be accomplished for the devil's purpose, O my master. But, Lord, every word which we are going to speak will bring life, 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 in the name of Jesus, O God. In the name of Jesus, O God. That's what we ask of you, O God. We bless your holy name, O God, O my master, for this word. And Lord, you, O Lord, teaching us, O God, you are reminding us, O God, O my master, to speak the right thing, O God, in every situation, O God, so that, Lord, your name will be glorified, because you have invested your son's precious blood on us, O God, for a purpose. And Lord, by speaking the wrong word, we will not, O Lord, condemn it, O God, but Lord, we will, O Lord, bring life, O God, in every situation, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Holy Spirit of God. We bless you. Bless Shaku, O my master. Multiply the anointing over our life, O my master. Reveal yourself unto our God more and more, in the name of Jesus, O God. Lord, I bless the congregation in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. O Lord, every jobless situation, O God, you will turn it around in the name of Jesus, O God. We decree a thing and it shall be established, O God, in the name of Jesus, O God. Everyone, O Lord, will be employed in the name of Jesus, O God. Your glorious offer letters will be released from heaven in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every sickness, O my master, will be gone away in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every struggle in the business, every struggle in the marriage, every struggle in the raising of children, every struggle, O God, of my master, in our financial situation will be gone in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Release your prosperity, release your anointing, release your blessing, release, O God, your word of, O Lord, encouragement over our lives in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We thank you, O God. O Lord, even we release the salvation upon the rulers of Sharjah in the name of Jesus, O God. O Lord, there will be Emirati church, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Yes, Lord, the locals will be saved. The people will bow before you and worship you, O God. O Lord, as the Son of God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. That's what we ask of you, O God. The truth will set everyone free in this Sharjah in the name of Jesus, O God. Fill these chairs, O God, with souls. We speak life into these chairs, O God, in the name of Jesus, O God. No more emptiness, O my master, but Lord, all the chairs will be filled by the thoroughbreds in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Only you can do it, O God, O my master. Souls are wandering, O God, O my master. Bring them and Lord, fill them, O God, with your spirit in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We thank you, O God, for the children. They performed, O Lord, all the things, O my master, for your glory this morning. We pronounce your blessings upon these children, O God. O Lord, anoint them, O God. O Lord, step by step, take them, O God. Little by little, they will take the ground for you in the name of Jesus, O God. Amazing talents, O God, you have placed upon them, O God. And Lord, these talents, O God, O my master, will come out and Lord, will be used for your glory in the name of Jesus, O God. Each child, O my master, we speak a blessing upon their lives, O God. And Lord, each teacher, O God, we speak a special reward over their lives, O God. They invested their time, their energy, their life, O my master, over these children, O God. O Lord, nothing will go wrong, but Lord, everything, O Lord, they will reap a great harvest in the name of Jesus. Bless every marriage of this church. Bless every job of this church, O God. Bless every children of this church, O God. Bless every, O Lord, womb, O Lord. O Lord, those who are carrying the child, O my master, in the name of Jesus, O God. We thank you. We bless you. We praise. We worship you. We adore. We magnify, O God, because all belongs to you. Lord, bless Israel. Bless Jerusalem. Let your peace, protection be upon your nation in the name of Jesus, O God. Bless your servants, O God, as they travel to Kenya. O Lord, bless them, anoint them, O God. And Lord, set the captives free in the name of Jesus, O God. If 300 pastors are coming, oh Lord, 300 churches will, oh Lord, experience a revival in the name of Jesus. Even 100 pastors are coming, 100 churches will be revived in the name of Jesus. God, set the heads free in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Remove, oh Lord, everything, oh God, every barrier, oh God, in the name of Jesus. God, Lord, the speak, oh Lord, we speak unity in the body of Christ in Kenya in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We bless you, we praise you, we worship you, we adore you. Oh Lord, the entire week, oh God, we commit them into your mighty hands, oh my master. You take complete control. You set everything in order for us, oh God, because your word says, oh God, our footsteps are ordered by you, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. We thank you, we bless you. Let the blessings of Sabbath, oh God, be our reward, be our, oh Lord, portion in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We love you, we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen. Now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us until he comes again. And all of us said, amen. 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 Thank you and good night. We'll see you next week. And we'll see you for the fasting prayer meeting. And come and experience the presence of God. Thank you and good night. God bless you.